Hey everyone, and welcome back to the news. So it is our first proper episode of the new year, and it's a pretty good one. We've got the 815 PTR, we've got the developer panel on storytelling, and we've got a little bit of industry news, including what's up with Mike Morheim. And we also have an experiment. I'm launching a second channel. I'm doing it today, right now, and there is a video on it that you can watch this very instant, or after this one. Many of you have enjoyed my coverage of industry news. I've heard that, and that's why this new channel exists, for that purpose. Head over there, and you will see a video about Bungie, how they freed themselves from Activision, what it means for Activision Blizzard, and what it means for Blizzard themselves, given all the speculation. That channel will not take away from this one. I've been building out the team for this channel and our operation. We are super efficient. We're at the stage where we can do both of these, and indeed, we still have new future series planned for this very channel as well. So head over to the new channel for industry news. If you're coming from this one, you will feel right at home. So that's something that I'm super excited about, but of course the news still needs to be covered, so let's jump in. All right, 8.1.5 is on the PTR, and yeah, man, it's nice to have something that's, you know, something going on, right? There's a fair amount here, there's ally races, there's new portal rooms, there's a whole bunch of interesting data mining. Now, it is a decently minor patch in the grand scheme of things, but it does seem like it's got the dual purpose of rounding out some of 8.1, as well as adding in some side features like the Brawler's Guild, and getting the allied races in, and, you know, setting up the eventual Crucible of Storm's Raid. Of course, the date of that's pretty hard to pin down. Release dates in general are hard to pin down, but I imagine this will be coming out pretty soon after the Battle for Dazar'alor LFR releases, because Blizz will want to get the allied races in people's hands, and it looks like that'll be the end of February. Now, there is a lot of story development going on here surrounding Bane and the old god-aligned roster of characters, but I'm going to experiment with breaking that lore discussion off just into its own videos later on once it's more solidified, and just keeping this more focused on, you know, on the news. So treat those things as like the, you know, the bonus news episodes like the Philip DeFranco show, kind of like that. Okay, with that, let's get a look at the content. Okay, first the portal rooms. So we've got two of them. There's one in Orgrimmar and one in Stormwind, and these basically exist to consolidate the various portals in the cities into an area that's actually designed to handle them, unlike the randomness that's seemingly going on with, say, the Cleft of Shadows, where there's just portals strewn all over the place. Now, it doesn't seem like the total number of final portals is confirmed yet, but we can actually just take a look at the new areas, and on the whole, I think they're pretty cool. You know, while I think that there is something to be said for the older direction of the game, where loading screens were definitely quite rare. Well, with the modern WoW, it is what it is, and I suppose embracing that and designing around it and making these unique areas for that purpose is probably a good idea. At the very least, they just will make getting around the place quite a bit easier. So with that, let's talk about the allied races, because the Zanzalari Trolls and the Kul'Tiran Humans are on their way. There has, of course, been a drama surrounding them, though. Why is that? Well, racials. The Zanzalari Trolls have insanely powerful abilities, but frankly, they're so powerful that it's clear they're placeholder, and Blizzard have kind of said as much. So, I don't really think we should get up in arms about it. I mean, I hope, like, if these numbers were even close to intended, then I would be flabbergasted. So, the Zanzalari can choose a patron Loa in return, and in return they'll get a big buff. Now, they seem to be really powerful, and they can be swapped around without a cooldown, which, seems pretty damn powerful. There's also a 90-second cooldown that gives you 25% HP every second for 4 seconds, which is clearly mental. So mental that there's no way they're release numbers, so we're probably fine. Okay, that's the allied race ability update. The rest of them are pretty much as they were. So that's what's up there. Now, there's some other stuff. You've got the final version of both of their armor sets. The Kul'Tiran one definitely has a lot of transmog potential, I'd say. It can definitely be matched with maybe the Kul'Tiran dungeon sets, stuff like that, pretty well. On the whole, though, both pretty strong, races visually, and that's further aided by having their Moonkin and incarnation forms being included in the data mining, as well as the Zandalari Paladin mount, which is pretty damn incredible. So, on the whole, quite good. Now, it'll be a little while yet before you actually get your hands on them, as, you know, this has only just hit the PTR. I would expect this all to come out after the third LFR wing opens. The unlock for these is pretty simple. You just need to be exalted with their main faction. You need to complete the story for, the zones of their continent, and you then need to complete the Tides of Vengeance war campaign. And the main news is you can do almost all of that right now. Just, of course, the final Tides of Vengeance war campaign is not unlocked yet, but it should be pretty simple. Okay, so next we've got the new battleground revamps. Show don't tell, so here's a quick little montage of what they look like. And then with that covered, it's time to talk about the Brawlers Guild. And you know, I'm really excited about this one. With, unfortunately, many of my friends leaving the game, I'm really in the mood for some challenging solo content. And, well, the new season of the Brawlers Guild, as with most new seasons, it's got some new bosses, presumably tweaks to some of the existing ones. And then in BlizzCon, they did say that there would be some narrative content. Past that, you can get Bruce as a mount, and he looks like a pretty battered up fellow, just like the new transmog sets, which certainly are not pretty, but definitely are on theme with the Brawlers Guild. So that's definitely a bit of content that I'll be looking forward to when the patch comes out. Next, there are Naga Assaults. These seem to be decently similar, in my mind, to the faction assaults that we're used to, and I mean, yeah, gameplay-wise, it should just be a skin and something that we're pretty familiar with, though, you know, admittedly, the design of the assaults is a good bit better than the Legion ones. So, yeah, that'll be just a little bit more variety, I suppose, in the game once this comes out. Of course, it's leading into the Crucible of Storms raid, and the Xalatath questline is actually sparked off by an item that drops from the Naga who were involved in the Naga invasion assault things. Next, we've got the data mining for the Hades scenario, so this is actually pretty good. I don't think it's actually playable yet, it's just that the broadcast text is in, but it's going to be in this patch. So many hunters will miss Hades from Legion. Well, for you, patch 8.1.5 is pretty good news, and it's great to see Blizzard listen to people's complaints in this one. I think that losing Hades probably felt worse than losing most artifacts because, well, you know, it's a hunter pet, and for the people who play hunters due to their fantasy, I think that would sting a bit more. So it's great to see that coming back in. Next, we've got the Dark Moon roller coaster. It's a roller coaster in World of Warcraft. Yeah, sure, I guess. I don't mean to be a dick about it. I mean, you know, it's the Dark Moon Fair. It's a bit of fun, a side activity. I actually, you know, I do champion devs putting in fun little non-essential things. Chromie's maybe the best example of that, maybe more so than a random roller coaster. But you know what? Hey, the Dark Moon Fair is a bit of fun, and I doubt this is taking away from anything else. So yeah, there's a roller coaster in the game now. Next up, we've got the Tools of the Trade. Now, while these were first data mined all the way back in Alpha, they do seem to be here in 8.1.5, and they are pretty similar to what we saw at BlizzCon, and there will be quest lines associated with them. Overall, I think they're a cool addition, but personally for me, I am looking for a more traditional take on professions, one that is focused on creating a large economy with complex and vibrant interactions. Basically something that is a bit less simplified than it is today, because really for me, the professions have been going downhill since Warlords of Draenor kind of gutted their complexity, and they've decided to kind of work back up from there, but I still don't think we're anywhere near how the professions used to be. So there you go, that is a bunch of stuff on the PTR based on the data mining, but it is early days yet, and Blizzard have actually done just an update post. They've said that they will be rolling out more as time goes on, so that includes the actual quest lines of the current data mining for the war campaign, the Warlords of Draenor time walking, the new player versus AI Arathi Highlands, the Wintergrasp epic battleground, which I'm pretty excited about, and the new profession quests themselves, as well as updates to Micro Holidays and Children's Week. It's not a massive patch, but then again, it's not really supposed to be, with patch 8.2 being the game's next major slice of content. So yeah, that's what's up. I mean, other than that, we'll have the two boss Crucible of Storms raid, the accompanying quests, and the Naga invasions, probably sometime after D'Zara Lore, which, I mean, yeah, maybe that'll be keeping us going until May? Maybe late April, maybe May for 8.2. Hard to tell. Oh, and then also, while this is not 8.1.5 news, we did actually just get a hotfix that makes mythic mount drops now be at a higher, just flat drop rate, rather than scaling with the number of people in the mythic raid. So overall, it's a great buff for people who want to go and solo old mythic raids for their mounts. So that's pretty great. Next up, we've got the narrative development panel. That happened, and really, I don't think there's that much to talk about. Basically, if you want to hear two really excited guys talking about the parts of their job that they love and that they're passionate about, check it out. As always, Steve and Taryn carry themselves fantastically. They seem like lovely people, and what you'll get there is more context from the people who are just working on all of this stuff. Now, personally, you know, I still do disagree with elements of the broad direction of the storytelling. For me, I would like less of the super dramatic character-driven stuff, and I'd like stuff that's more focused on the realities and the strategies of the faction war. For me, the writing for an MMO shouldn't feel like a novel. I think it should feel like an RPG sourcebook. Right now, I feel like we have novel segments interspersed by gameplay segments, with things like, say, faction assaults being, you know, a rare integration of the narrative into the game world in a way that feels a bit more natural from the player's perspective. So I think that's most of what I'd like to say on it. I think there were some expectations about it going in that weren't met. I think that's because Blizzard didn't really intend to meet those expectations, and that's kind of a community expectation. So yes, personally, I would have loved to have maybe heard them address what's up with you know, say what's going on with the undead, right? Like the undead and Darkshore and why characters are just changing their, you know, allegiance so quickly, and, you know, just what their thoughts are and how quickly they flip that switch. And of course, one thing that they, you know, have said is that it's a big expanding narrative, you know, that the chapters will roll out over time. And they talked about how they do like to have the game roll out in that way so that, you know, every few weeks, maybe you get something new. What I'd say to that is I just kind of worry, because imagine playing Uncharted 4, but one mission a week or one mission a month. That would really kill the pacing of that game. So I feel like their current approach has led to a more spread out and consistent amount of story, but I think it's been at the expense of the quality of that story, because I just don't feel like they've been able to really pace segments that well. And I don't mean pacing in terms of content pacing, I mean pacing in terms of narrative pacing, because at the end of the day, while a lot of people will say, yeah, we're only a third of the way into this book, you can't judge an entire book based on the first third. And I would actually kind of disagree. I'd say that if the first third of a book doesn't capture me, I'm not going to read the second third or the third third. So that's kind of my thoughts on narrative, but it was an enjoyable live stream if you're going into it wanting to hear two passionate guys talking about the stuff that they love, which, while it may not be massively newsworthy for what I'm doing right here, it is definitely interesting from a personal level. And next up, we do have some sad news. Mike Morhaime is going to be gone. Gone. He left as president, obviously, with J. Allen Brack coming in, and, you know, he was then in an advisory role. That advisory role is ending. It was just announced in, I believe, an SEC filing. So Mike Morhaime is going to have zilch, zero to do with Blizzard as of April of 2019. So just a few months' time. And overall for me, I find it hard to speculate too much into this. It would be really possible to talk about how, oh, the old guard are dead. Blizzard is dead. It's a new era. I don't know how much that's true. And when I look at Mike's recent tenure, you know, as I've mentioned, Overwatch, slow content development. It was his team that made that decision to cancel Diablo 3 Expansion 2 and had the whole thing with Fenris and Hades. So, I mean, yeah, like from a personal level, it is still really sad. And while I'm sure that if I was to speculate and it felt a bit doomy and gloomy, I'm sure some of that would pretty much end up on the mark. But at this stage, without knowing a bit more about the company, I find it hard to kind of speculate authoritatively on the subject. And I kind of feel like doing that too much would not be helpful. But still, there is a lot of Activision Blizzard news to talk about, so let's get into it. I mean, come on, it wouldn't be the news if there wasn't some Acti Blizz stuff to talk about. We have had two CFOs leave, as rather than jump on this as soon as it happened, I thought it would be better to hang back, wait until the dust settled, and give just a sort of a more reason to count, I suppose, than the immediate reactions. There's a lot of doom and gloom over this one, as well as confusion over what a CFO does. So CFO stands for Chief Financial Officer, and it's a really important role that is related to the financial direction of the company, but it's also a very, very high-level role. It's a very decision-making-focused kind of role. From our perspective, it mostly is just a boring corporate type of job. As an example, a CFO may be working in something such as lowering a company's effective tax rate by working, structuring their taxes or structuring their accounts more efficiently. So that's the kind of stuff that they're doing. So isn't ActiBliz CFO calling Blizzard and telling them to do a Stormout promotion? No, they may be involved in a broad financial plan and direction that involves that, but they're just not that low level of a decision maker. So that's kind of what's up with the CFO. It's a high corporate role that's not massively gaming related. So with that covered, let's talk about what actually happened. Now, Spencer Neumann, the CFO of Activision Blizzard, was fired from the company. He was then almost immediately picked up by Netflix, and in a statement, Activision Blizzard said that he was fired for breaching his legal obligations to the company and that it was not related to the company's current stock performance. So you might be wondering what actually happened. Well, Spencer's contract, of course, had a clause which said that he couldn't shop around for another job while in his current role until a given date. Well, it seems like Netflix had been headhunting him. What probably happened is that he got an offer from Netflix, got fired from Blizz because of that, and then likely got a great deal from Netflix, including them paying off whatever fines were stipulated by his contract. So Spencer seems to have, done really well for himself. He's now on a $10 million salary from Netflix on top of a $1.7 million bonus. That might seem insane to you, but it's worth remembering that the economy of executives It's not literally like footballers, but in a way it's kind of like that. As an example, he could be the person who would maybe be involved in orchestrating a tax restructuring that would reduce the company's overall liability, and that would save them far, far, far more than his salary. So that's Spencer. Next, we've got Amrita Ahuja. She has been with Activision Blizzard for 8 years, including her recent tenure at Blizzard Entertainment, where she was the CEO. Of course, Blizzard Entertainment is a unit of Activision Blizzard. So she moved over there in 2017, and the recent cost-cutting measures seem to have been spearheaded by her. Now, it could be the Blizzard leadership decided they needed to clean up their act. Maybe they phoned up Big Bobby upstairs and got him to fire her over from Activision. And it's important to know that while there is concern, including concern from current employees about Activision Blizzard's control over Blizzard Entertainment, it's not like Blizzard Entertainment themselves have a perfect track record. Their recent slump is mostly on them. Overwatch being content light, HOTS not succeeding. Mike's management, at the end of the day, are the people who can D3 Expansion 2. D4 Expansion 1 was rebooted, so it could be that Blizzard management under Mike were feeling a bit antsy about the way things were going and felt like they needed an external influence to help clean up shop. I know that is speculation, but I think it's kind of reasonable. Anyway, so she left Blizzard Entertainment and Activision Blizzard as a whole, and she has now moved on to being the CFO of the payment company Square. We don't know who's replacing her or what that could mean for Blizzard. And before we get on to the opinion section, it is worth noting that Activision Blizzard's new CFO is actually their old CFO from before Newman. So Dennis Durkin is back in the job. He is notable for, he was actually there for quite a while. He's very notable for orchestrating their buyout from Vivendi, which is pretty big news a few years back. He's got a long history in the games industry, and rather interestingly, he's also in charge of Activision Blizzard's emerging businesses kind of section, and I'm assuming that's just another like corporate wing that is maybe managing new very growth oriented products, which kind of means mobile. That's kind of speculation, but it seems reasonable. So that's what's up with Dennis, but the suit musical chairs does not stop there, because on the Blizzard front, of course, but the executive reshuffling has continued. The COD executive VP is now the president of Activision, and King also has a new president. And it's kind of interesting because Dennis Durkin seems to be quite involved with them, so I'm assuming that they're just having him work with the unit presidents to maybe steer the ship better. So that's what's up. And look, after all, it's no secret that Activision Blizzard stocks have not been doing great. While revenue has actually been strong, of course, companies, they're valued not on their current value, but on their potential future value. So, a slew of bad news, like with what ActiBliz has had, that on top of general poor market performance in Q4 of 2018 likely means that things weren't feeling great for the two outgoing CFOs. It could just be that they saw greener pastures, or they simply, like Spencer, maybe just got a fantastic offer. I have no idea about Amrita, but of course for Spencer, well, your boy's covered. He's got $10 million a year. So that's what's happened to the corporate front. I don't think that it's worth speculating too much on a lot of this stuff. To be honest, I think it would be irresponsible without getting a second opinion. Now, on that, I do actually know some pretty successful businessy people, actually through family friends. Definitely in a different industry, but they're corporate types. They've got some crazy stories, but maybe that's something I'll reach out and just get some opinions from people who just know more about the corporate world than I do. So I'll let you know if that happens. But overall, that is what's up with the Activision Blizzard news. I don't know what to make of it, but there you go. There it is. And there we have it for the news. So that's not really where the news is ending, though, is it? Because there's another full news video on the other channel. There'll be a thing to click somewhere. Maybe it'll be up here. Maybe it'll be up there. I don't really know which side it'll go on. There'll be a link in the description, probably. Might even put it in the pinned comment. How fancy. Yeah, new channel. More news. If you want me tackling the industry news in a way that is similar to how I approach the World of Warcraft stuff, that's what we're going to be doing over there. For the most part, my MO is with the big stories, right? There's a big story. Everyone's talking about it. That will be covered, and much like with what I try to do with the WoW stuff, I'll, bring people in, and then the hope is to go to a more reasoned position. And I think more so than with the WoW stuff, and I know everyone rightly memes on me for, mentioning that I do the game development stuff. And I think a lot of that is because, I've been doing that for like 2.5 years. We have zero release games. And like, I currently know the things that when I leave this recording room, I'm going to be sitting down to work on, and the plans that we're making and all of that stuff. But of course, you don't see that, and it would be irresponsible of me to share that with you. What I will say is that through it, at the very least, I've got to talk to a lot of smart people, people who are smarter than me, and I've been able to learn from those people. And that just means that there's a little bit more of sort of inside industry knowledge into how some of the cogs work. I kind of want to bring that to bear on the game industry news segment because, you know, it's one of those things. I see this big market. I see a lot of people talking, about this stuff. And I don't mean to cast aspersions on anyone, but a lot of the times I kind of feel like, you know, this, I get your take. I get where it's coming from. But, you know, if I try to think about this realistically, taking all sides into account, some of it doesn't feel that balanced. So that's kind of what I want to provide for the game industry segment, I suppose, with news on YouTube. And of course, a lot of you have asked me to do that. And I thought that rather than clogging up this channel, because the people who've subscribed here are primarily subscribed for World of Warcraft, I think that maybe a third of the people who watch my videos are interested in the other stuff. So rather than clogging up everyone's feeds, I'm just going to go onto another channel so that it's not, just so that it's more separate and people are opting into the things that they want. So, I would love it if you check it out, give it a chance. That's something that will develop and get better over time. It's over there, you can check it out now. And just that's for this video. Thank you very much for watching it. The Wrath Doc Part 3, I believe, is the next video coming out on this channel. So if you want 20 minutes, maybe 25 minutes, I think, of Wrath of the Lich King loveliness, that's coming pretty soon. And with that, thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.